Looking to improve your life, brush up on your personal growth techniques? You are in the right place. Welcome to Life's Little Lessons with your host, author of Designing Your Own Destiny, Kevin A. Dunlap.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Life's Little Lessons. My name is Kevin Dunlap, and I will be the host of your show. And today I have a person that actually runs a business in two different countries. Her name is Adriana Bautista. Hopefully I didn't butcher that too bad. So this is Adriana Bautista. She has a company called LPP Incorporated, and she is an international tax consultant. She works both in the United States for people preparing their taxes here in this country, and she also works in Mexico, so people that are filing their taxes in that country as well. And I will find out, I don't know the answer to this, what about people that live in both countries? I'd like to find out a little bit about what she does with those people that makes money in both countries. So anyway, I want to introduce you to the lady. She has businesses in two different countries, and her name is Adriana. Adriana, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Kevin.
Well, I'm glad to have you here today. And you're the first person that I've had that was operating consistently a business in two countries. Now, I've had a couple of Canadians on the show that have worked outside of Canada, but you're the one, you're running a business that's actually physically on a regular basis working in two different countries. Is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct.
Okay, so tell me a little bit about yourself. What is it that you do? I know you're a tax consultant, but what is it that you do, and how did you get started, and how long ago was that?
Yeah, I practically prepare taxes, and I help people advising in how to do the correct thing in two countries. I started with this business since 1999, okay. And I started practically in Mexico City.
Okay, so you started originally in Mexico, okay.
Yes, So in 2007, I started having the idea to come to the States and open a company, even though I was doing U.S. and Mexican taxes, but I wanted to expand to United States. And that dream was for 3 years, 2008, 2009, so until that became reality in 2010.
2010? Okay, so the original concept was in 2007, but it became reality in 2010. Now, were you already doing U.S. tax planning, I guess, for Mexican citizens that also, I guess, were working in the U.S. for some reason?
Yeah, for Mexican citizens that receive income in United States, but mainly for expats living in Mexico, because one of the things that people don't know is U.S. citizens, they have to file by nationality. It doesn't matter where they live and where they receive the income. So let's say U.S. citizens that they never have been living in the States and they live in Mexico they have to declare because there's the residency, and Mexico goes by residency, and United States they have to file because they are U.S. nationals. So the main business is about expats living in Mexico. And yes, I was doing U.S. taxes in Mexico at that point.
Okay, so I have no idea how national taxes, state taxes, and now national taxes, and I guess Mexico is also breaking down into states as well. I'm not sure about that.
Fortunately, it doesn't go by a state there. Everything goes federal, so we don't have that difficulties. Like every state is different, except 5 states here in the States that you don't file the state taxes. In Mexico, no. In Mexico, everything is federal.
Okay. So how different are the taxes between national U.S. and federal Mexico?
Really about, if you make a comparison about federal taxes, Mexico, U.S., that is not a big issue. It's just income less expenses. Yes, there are certain laws that apply that they are different, but at the end it's almost the same calculation, income less expenses. The difference here is coming when in the States, you are living in a state or you are receiving an income in another state in United States. Let's say like you are living in New York. You just don't have to file federal, you just have to file a state also. So that is different from Mexico. It doesn't matter where are you receiving your income, you are always going to pay federal and you don't have the obligation to pay by state.
So somebody that's doing business in both countries could be paying a lot of taxes then?
Not really, because you have, when you know international law, you can apply the credits. So, which means that, let's say that you are living in the States and you are receiving income from Mexico, you are paying taxes in Mexico. So when you do your U.S. tax return, you put your income from Mexico as well. You can take the credit for the taxes that you pay.
Okay, I'm a little confused about that, but maybe the listeners are following that. So, I'm sure as with the internet the way that it is today, and people are starting to do businesses in multiple countries, or people might be looking for ways to not pay so much in taxes in their one country. They want to offset it by making income in another country. So you, obviously you're the type of person that could, at least with Mexico and the U.S., you could say, okay, this is what you should be doing in order to capitalize on the best tax strategy. Is that correct?
Yeah. And it can be for other countries also, because as soon as you know the U.S. tax system, and also in Mexico, you come from another country, you know, it's very easy to determine when they show you the tax returns, like how to apply the credits. And I have clients in China, I have clients in Spain, in Chile, I have clients in Brazil, in Honduras. So practically, yes, the 40 is with Mexican and U.S., but we can do for other nationalities also.
Oh, wow. Okay. You're the first person that I've ever come across that can do things, as far as I know, internationally. Every CPA or tax preparer that I personally know can only do U.S.
We can work with that people doing the U.S. or Mexican taxes. So which means that we can read, we can understand their taxes on their country. Because again, it's just every country is income less expenses. So then it's just you determine what are the credits, what are the taxes that they pay. So I cannot do taxes from Honduras, but I can help that people from Honduras if they are doing taxes, if they are U.S. citizens, so they have to declare in the States or they have to declare in Mexico. Yeah, definitely I cannot do taxes from Honduras or any other country except U.S. or Mexico, but I can help that people that are doing business in two countries, in those two countries.
Okay. Oh, wow. So how long have you been doing this for? I mean, you said you started in 1999?
So 18 years with that business, because I have been working before. You know, when we start in the school, we start like bookkeepers. So I have been doing that like for maybe 23.
Okay. Wow. So were you working for somebody else at that time, or was that your own business as well?
No, before I was working for someone else, but just in the Mexican taxes. And 1999 is when I started for the U.S. taxes.
Okay. Well, you seem like you really love what you're doing. I'm a numbers person, but I'm not an accountant by any means. So how did you get into that? And what was your fascination for doing this in different countries?
Well, I get in love about being an accountant since I was 5 years old, because I saw my sister Angie, she wanted to be an accountant. So one day I asked her and I said, "What are you doing?" And she said, "I just saw numbers and numbers and numbers." And she said, "I'm going to be an accountant." And I say, "I want to be an accountant too." So I put that dream in my heart.
So a 5 year old, where most people wanted to be astronauts and firefighters and dancers and whatever, you're saying, "I want to be an accountant."
Yeah, she was my role model. So after that, I just keep my dream in my heart and I continue and continue until I achieve that. So then I start working in this company that already exists, doing Mexican taxes. They were doing the U.S. taxes also. So, but I'm saying, these are really interesting. At that time, I didn't speak in English at all. So I wanted to learn and I said, "I want to learn." And they laugh at me and they say, "Sure, you didn't even speak English." And I say, "Just show me and you will see." So they bought like 5 books for me to study. So they put in my desk and they say, "Show us that you really want to do this." So 3 months later, I tell them, "Here is, and I can prove it to you." So they were very surprised. And then we hired a private professor that is very good on international U.S. taxes. And he gave me private classes. And from then, they were surprised at how quick I learned. And he just approved that when you want something and you really focus and work for that, you can have it.
Okay. And I'm assuming, because if you're doing U.S. taxes, it depends on the state as well. Because Nevada, where I live, there's no state income tax. And but in other states, Texas or New York, they're going to have high tax rates there.
Yeah, and it's very exciting, you know, because sometimes we have clients that they receive income from California, from New York, from Washington. So every time we do a tax return, we have to do the federal, plus we have to do the state, and we have to go to the state to see specifically how much days they spend there, and if they didn't spend days, how much money they make there, because we have to follow the rules of each state. In some states they have to do taxes, in some other no. But yeah, we have to do a lot of research because they might have to file according to the level of income they have or not. So every year is like, I love to work with individuals because companies are kind of boring. But individuals, every individual is different. They have so many different situations. Oh, no, I love my work.
Okay, well, I could tell. Now, because you were talking about businesses and personal, because there's a lot of entrepreneurs, solopreneurs out there, and people that are, you know, that are doing their, that need to have their taxes done. So you do work with small businesses as well?
But reality is more focused on individuals. I will tell you something. I call my business like a machine to do tortillas. Okay. I just want to deal with you doing your taxes. Thank you. Goodbye. So because I like to learn from people. So having many clients, you know, I create a very nice relationship with my clients and I learn. So my mind has to be very active, and just being focused in one company or something takes a lot of time and it's just not part of my phone because I have to learn from everywhere. It's just not just doing the taxes. It's just about the person, what they are doing. It's very interesting when you are doing taxes, you can read a lot about the people. Like, so that's why I love individuals. Yeah.
Okay. Now, so with, because I haven't filed as just as an individual in I don't know how many years. I mean, 1048, 1040 EZ were the ones that I would use back when I had a job. Now I've been self-employed, so I've got write-offs, I've got meals expenses, I've got gasoline charges and things like that. But I know for me as an entrepreneur, as a single business entrepreneur, actually multiple businesses, you know, is getting all those write-offs done correctly and carry over from previous years or not for other expenses, you know, like big capital expenses.
So, yeah.
Okay. Fantastic. And you've got into it when you were as a kid, assuming you went to school for it, or did you go to college for and get a accounting or tax preparer degrees or?
Yeah, so I studied my career as an accountant, and then fortunately, that was my dream, just to have my career, my profession. So, but then having friends, they pushed me to go for my master's degree in tax law in Mexico as well. And then they keep pushing me, so I went for my PhD. I had not been, when I was 30, I was finishing already the PhD school. I had not been finishing, well, I did finish my thesis, but we are working in how to pass or not to pass. You know, you have to go through a lot of review, and sometimes the professors, they accept or not. And also I took a postgraduate course in taxes because more than accounting, I love taxes. I love to do taxes, analyze, and then I passed all my tests and my certifications to be able to be authorized to sign tax returns in U.S. So I am authorized in two countries, in my country and here, everything legally.
Okay, so you do have your PhD. Oh, fantastic. I did not know that. I was asking that as a blank question. Like, I did not know the answer to even just going and getting your bachelor's degree, much less, you know, a master's and a PhD. So, yeah. You obviously love this. I mean, you're doing it for 18 years. You did, 8 years of school or more, possibly, doing all of this. And so what was it about taxes that excites you so much? I can see when you look in your face, your excitement. However, most of the people that are experiencing this show are only listening to it because it's a podcast. So the people that are watching the video, they can see the excitement on your face. So what was, and I know it was your older sister, but what's got you so invigorated with taxes these days?
You know, it's something like it's coming from my heart. It's like a special connection I have with laws. I am very smart, and you know, this is not coming from my ego. This is coming from when you have passion, when it's coming from your heart, you learn and you can fly with the knowledge. So when people are asking questions, it's so beautiful just to answer, this is going to happen here, this is going to happen there. And if you handle in this way, you are going to have this result and this result. So imagine when you combine the two countries, how you have to handle this and the other. It feels so good, like when somebody is coming and asking you and you have the answer there and you are just like with the flow. So it's just something that is there that I just love to express to people.
Well, I'm surprised you don't teach. I mean, with such a passion and helping
people. It's coming.
So you're going to actually start teaching or creating programs so you could help other people possibly do stuff on their own? So where do you see yourself?
Where I see myself, I'm going to be giving, I have been conferences and I have been teaching, not too much because I was focused in growing the business here, and I went through a little depression coming here, so that I think we are going to talk that later with another kind of conversation. But I definitely see myself as a consultant. Okay, more than doing taxes, I see myself as a consultant and going to big companies because, to be honest, I don't know one person that is like me that knows the two countries and then they just like flow. I don't know anyone until now. And when I go and I talk to people, they get surprised and they say, oh my God. So I know that my knowledge can be solved very well. And it's just a matter of a time because I had to put all the puzzle together. So, you know, I took a lot of training and I think that's how we met because I was having all this knowledge about taxes, but I knew that I needed something else to be able to go to the next step. So thankfully, with all the training that we have been taking, so has been giving me the tools to go for the next step.
Okay. Well, which trainings are you talking about so that the audience knows and understands?
Well, fortunately, Wizard Camp is that I met you. So that one, the Warrior Camp, I have been taking for the speaker with John Maxwell, and I have been taking the coaching. And I am taking also the practitioner on NLP and neuro-linguistic programming.
Okay.
So a lot of training that has been giving me a lot of confidence to go for the next step because the truth is that I am an accountant and a spiritual, and I am not like people think I am a square. It's just like people don't believe that I am an accountant because I'm so different and speak and smile and happy that they say, are you really a tax return preparer? Are you really an accountant? So I wanted to develop all these other sites to be able to go for the areas I want. So because, I developed a lot myself in the law, which means all the tax codes. But it was not too much developed, like let's say, how to deal with people and how to gain more confidence. So I needed that balance for me to be able to feel confident.
Okay. Oh, okay. And because I know I've gone through a lot of trainings myself, and it's because of those trainings is why I'm doing with a lot of stuff that I'm doing now. You went through some similar ones. We've gone through different ones ourselves. And for those of you out there that are listening or watching this show, go out there and go to conferences. I mean, we both did NLP training, which is neuro-linguistic programming. We both done that. Do we know each other through Peak Potentials or? Yes. Because Peak Potentials, which is now called Success Resources, which is a whole series of different classes. I've done things through PSI seminars. I've done stuff through other individual trainers. Go out there and do that. Even if it's not, in this case, you're not doing tax trainings. I'm not doing business coaching trainings. But, you know, going out there and and surrounding yourself with other people that have the entrepreneurial spirit that want to actually do something more, because you never know who's going to be out there that could be part of your support system. I know some of my closest, dearest friends are from classes that I met like this, and they are, some of them are entrepreneurs, some of them aren't, and they have been my support system when I was writing my book, for an example, back in 2016 and releasing it in 2016. A lot of it, you know, my friends from before those classes probably would have said, why are you writing a book? So who are you to write a book? You don't have a degree in journalism or English or literature or anything like that. And so I've actually ended up writing two books, all because of surrounding myself with other kinds of people that I meet at conferences. So I'm glad you brought that up, because, and she's shaking her head like vigorously. She's agreeing with me. Okay, and so let me ask you this then, because you've been doing this for quite some time, you're making good money on it, you're now thinking about doing more of the consulting where you're more of a trainer more so than just doing people's taxes or giving them tax advice. Where do you see yourself going in the next few months or in the next year?
In the next year, I will be having another certification with the IRS. I'm going to be applying to be an advocate, but at the international level. Okay. So the advocates are the intermediaries between the taxpayers and the IRS. So you have to put a lot of time and have a lot of knowledge, but since I really love to study and learn, so to me it's my passion, but I want to be, everything I want to do is at the international level, that for sure. So, and then in the next year, and it means 2019, I am going to work with a big company. Means talking like PricewaterhouseCoopers. Why? Because now I want to model and I want to analyze and study what they are doing at that level. And after that, with all that knowledge that I'm going to have, I'm going to put that to work into my business, and at the same time, I'm going to be able to give tax advice in another level. We are talking about with large companies.
Okay, so you do want to eventually work for the big guys, for the big people as well?
No. Oh, yeah, means work like a tax consultant.
Okay.
I always think as an independent, I always think as my own business. But yeah, I want to go to work for someone. It's just to model, just to see what I can learn, because I am ready to go to that level. And how is what is the only way that you can learn? It's just through experience, right? It's just doing it with people that they are doing it already. So just working with them for 1 year. And then it's just after everything I learned from there, it's just let's see what is going to happen. But definitely it's going to be focused on tax consulting and probably just to know how to market myself in other countries, just to teach the accountants how to deal, because there is a big international movement with taxes that more and more people needs to know English and needs to know how to deal with one another country on the taxes, because tax authorities in all the countries are becoming very hard with the taxpayers. And if they are not doing the correct thing, it's going to be big problems. So this is a big market there. And I think I'm going to be one of the first ones that are going to start doing it.
And I love the way that you're kind of making it sound like a small thing that, hey, I don't want to be national, I want to be international. So you're already dreaming big, and have been achieving that. So that this is amazing. So I want the listeners to hear your passion, hear what you're doing, because you are dreaming, you're thinking big, and you're accomplishing big goals, and much bigger than I'm sure a lot of people are looking at. She's like, oh my gosh, then she's doing so much better than we are. And that's because you got those big lofty goals, and you're willing to put in the hard work to achieve those goals as well.
Yeah.
So, okay. Well, I'm going to shift the game plan a little bit here, and because you've been in business for quite some time, and so I'd like to just talk to you about some of your early successes that you had. These are going to be successes that you had maybe when you're just starting out in 2010, when we opened up in the U.S., or back in 1999 when you actually started your business, or probably even when you were still doing just getting started with your business. So what were some of your early successes that you had in getting started?
When it was to open the company here.
Okay.
No, it was not difficult. What it was difficult was to take the decision. That part that was difficult, because being in Mexico and all my family in Mexico, Mexican families were very close. So my main concern was like, oh, what am I going to do if I go there? What is going to happen with my family? It's like, even though you are there, some things can happen. But the mind lies to you and say, oh, if I go there, I am not protecting them. So the difficult part was to take the decision to move.
Okay. And you acted on it pretty quickly after you made the decision? Or was it, or is this part of the 3-year, the 2007 to 2010 process that you mentioned earlier?
No, the decision was all the time. I know I have to do it, but I don't want to do it yet. I want to do it. But again, I have a lot of people around me that push me to do things. So one of my friends, he told me, let's go to the States. And I say, okay. So surprise. He say, you are going to stay here and you don't have to worry because we already hire a manager in Mexico. So it was through someone else that pushed me that make this to happen. And after that, it was like, okay, I am here. Perfect. No problem. So let's go for that. But reality is that kind of brotherhood that I have with people, friends, clients, family, you know, when they're helping you to achieve goals is amazing. So when you open yourself to listen those ideas and to follow what they are saying, so it's very interesting. So, and that's why practically it was like somebody, you know, you go and you do it. So it's like when you have to fly from an airplane, you do it, you save your life or you are dead. So that was that way.
Okay. And that's good that you had a friend of yours that actually held you accountable and forced you to, in a way, forced you to get started. Because, I mean, and that's sometimes, you know, you'll see it in the movies or something like that, like a skydiving thing that you were just referencing. That person's afraid to jump, just push them. Okay.
Then it's fun.
You got to go.
Yeah. And then it's fun. And you say, oh, I take so long for this. But, you know, that is part of the path. And that's what friends are there for sometimes. And sometimes we have to take the decision by our own. But yeah, always people say it, just taking the decision is more difficult than the little thing you have to do it.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's good. Yeah. I'm glad that you did, because once that decision was kind of made for you, you just started taking the action that you needed to take and you were able to build what you build. So those of you that are out there, if you are hesitant on doing something, go ahead and do it anyway. You've heard this on a number of different shows of people saying, just jump off the cliff, jump out of the airplane, just got to do it. And Adriana here is saying the exact same thing. She says, you know, she was hesitant on doing something for so long, but once you got kind of like pushed, now it's like, why didn't I do this way back when? What could I have accomplished if I did it when I first thought about it? So it's probably going to be easier than you think. But it's the hardest part is what she was saying is actually making the decision and then acting on taking that first action step.
So, yeah.
Okay. Now, what are some of your current successes that you're going through right now? I mean, as you're growing your business, I know you were sharing some of that already, but what are some of your current successes that you're going through?
It was to give me the permission to take all this other training, to be able to make my mind happy, allowing myself to go to different paths. Because all the time was about taxes, but it was a point that my heart was tired and wanted something different. So accepting that, okay, I am going to go for all these other trainings like NLP and like coaching. So I think that was very interesting to don't feel attached that always to be working as an accountant.
Okay. And then let me ask you this, kind of like the flip side of the successes. What were some of your initial fears when we were just getting started, either back in 1999 or in 2010? Some fears that you either had to overcome that may have been overwhelming or at that time you thought were going to be overwhelming. And how did you get past those fears?
Well, I will tell you, in 1999, no, I didn't have any fear. I was very brave and I just went right through for things. Because I was in my country, all my family was there, and I have all the support. But the part that took me so long to take the decision is, well, my English is not very good. English is my second language. And to be honest, is in my country, in Mexico, always you hear that in United States, you cannot see people because they can sue you. That you cannot walk on the street on the wrong side because you are going to have a penalty. That you have to chew well because you are going to have a penalty. That you cannot do this because you are going to have a penalty. So everything that goes to in my country is that somebody is going to sue you or somebody is going to put you in jail or give you a penalty. So I was like, oh my God, I'm going to go to another country alone. My English is not that good. So, and then I'm going to start a business. How I'm going to be doing it, even though I was doing it in Mexico, how I'm going to be doing it, how I'm going to comply with the laws. Like, how I'm going to be driving, you know, just driving. What happened if I pass the red light? What about if I'm going to do this? What about, so all these questions, what if? So it just moving to the country was very, very hard because all those kind of things, instead to be thinking all the beauty and all the good things I can do, I just was thinking like, try to don't do that. Almost it's like, don't get out of your house, and that way you are not going to be in trouble.
Obviously, most of those fears were all unjustified and are blown out of proportion. Because you're not going to walk, there's no such thing as walking on the wrong side of the street or walking on the wrong side of the sidewalk, or you're chewing wrong. You're chewing with your mouth open. I mean, you're going to get a penalty. But the thing is, I can understand that because if you don't know another country, another culture, you just don't know. I mean,
yeah.
So yeah, I can definitely understand that because if you're going to another country, like say for an example, I'm going to go open up a business in Moscow. I don't know Russian traditions. I don't know, you know what it's going to be like doing in that kind of a country. I don't know what's going on there. I don't even understand their government or their politics or things like that. So I could fully understand why. You know, you're going to another country, and I don't know how many people are listening to this show or most likely are U.S. citizens. They probably say, that's so funny that you would think that. Think of yourself if you were going to go to another country, if you're a U.S. citizen. Oh, I'm going to go live in Mexico City. Okay, well, there's a lot of crime down there. There's a lot of exact same unfounded things that we would have project on you or Russia or whomever. You guys would have the exact same fears and things about coming even to the U.S. So I never thought about it from that perspective, but thank you for sharing that. Thank you. So you had your biggest fears about coming to the U.S. Now, let's talk about some of your challenges and some of your possibly your failures or your setbacks. What kind of things, issues came up to you that you may have not thought of that may have caused things to change? And you could be as vulnerable as you want to be or as honest as you want to be here. But what were some challenges or setbacks that occurred to you? And how did you get past them?
One of the challenges, how to get to the customers, okay. Because in Mexico we are GATS. You know, we are doing international taxes for the expats there, and we are the only one.
Okay.
So here we are talking about H&R Block, and we are talking about all the other companies. So the challenge is going to start bringing clients and how to get them, and for them to don't go to a franchise. Because normally people here goes for what is commercial. So, and instead to be going with us. So, that is one of the challenges that I see that, I think is going to, I will be over that as soon as I start focusing on how to get to that people. But right now, since I have not been working too much on doing that, I still consider that as a challenge.
Okay. And I can understand that because a lot of people, they'll go to the H&R Block, so they go to that, or they use the do-it-yourself tax software themselves. But, you know, you being an excellent individual that you could talk to, you are the small business person, which that actually is more focused on the client rather than, hey, you're just a cog in the wheel and let's process you. So that's one of the beauties of, you know, going with individuals that are small businesses is you do get that more of that personal touch to it.
Okay. Yeah.
And you shared a little bit about some of your next steps, your 12 or 24 months. Could you just reiterate some of the things that you plan to do, you know, as your game plan? Because I know you were talking about going into consulting. You wanted to start working for these bigger powered companies. What is it? Where do you see yourself with your consulting services or your possibly training services in the next 1 to 2 years?
Yeah, next year, this year in 2018, my plan is to have the other certification with the IRS. Then finishing all the training that I am still going like for NLP. And in 2009, again, is to go to work with one of those companies. And after that, it's just I want to be focused, keep the company here. Keep the company doing taxes, having employees. But the main thing I want to do is I like to study. I like to do research. And it just be paying by, it's like a consulting. Just giving consulting on giving training because I really love to teach. I really love to share what I know. So those main things I want to, that is my plan for a business in the business perspective. And in the personal perspective, I have a mission. My brother died in September last year. So if someone believes in the spirits, he came to ring my mission. And he told me that my mission is to help and to work with Latin women. So as part of my personal life, I'm going to be helping people. And I'm working already in a book that is called The Book That Rises of Self-Esteem.
The book is called what? Rise of Self-Esteem?
The Book That Rises Self-Esteem.
Okay. This is the book you're writing right now?
Yeah. So I am going to be doing, I am going to be a motivational, inspirational speaker. So I want to go out and touch the hearts of these ladies who has been abused and help them to overcome to that and help them to achieve their dreams.
Okay. Well, fantastic. And there's always more need for, especially female speakers. I mean, there's a few out there, but what I've seen, there's not anywhere near as many female speakers as there are male speakers. And the fact that you have a purpose, a cause for Latin women, and you're, when I gather, Latin women that were abused, either relationships, either from their husbands or fathers, or somehow they were, I'm assuming, physical abuse, or you talk about also mental?
Both.
Okay, and that's very noble of you, and thank you. When do you think your book's going to be out?
August or September of this year.
September of 2018. Okay, so at the recording of the show, we're just turning into 2018. So she wants to have her book out, you know, within the next few months, and that's a very noble cause. I mean, I'm a two-time author myself. Now, is your book going to be self-published? And I'm going to assume self-published in the U.S. Or are you going through a publisher in the U.S. Or are you going through a publisher in Mexico?
In Canada, it's Raymond Aron.
Oh, at Raymond Aron.
Yes. Yeah, I am working with him. Yeah, and I'm going to do after, I'm doing in English, and then I'm going to be doing in Spanish. So it's that book really has to hit all the countries because I consider self-esteem is the more important thing we have to be able to go out and achieve our goals. So everything has to, is within in us. So that's what I want to focus all in self-esteem. And I also am working, I am going to be the co-author of another book. So the book is called The Trophy Effect. It already exists in English and is has been written by Michael Nitti.
Okay.
Michael Nitti is one of the coaches that works with Tony Robbins. He's my coach, and he chose me as to be the co-author of The Trophy Effect in Spanish. So I'm working on that book also, and probably December of this year has to be on the market.
Okay, so within the next 11 to 12 months, you'll have be the co-author of a second book. So two book releases, two book launches within a couple of months of each other. That's
yeah.
Okay, well, more power to you on that. And you're working on these other certifications at the same time, and you're still doing your job, and you're growing your misses as well. So you've got a lot going on in 2018.
Yeah.
Well, I'm very proud of you, and more power to you. If you need somebody to hold you accountable to make sure that you are getting your book out there, I'll be more than happy to be that person to hold you. There's another gentleman that I just interviewed the other day, and he wants his book out by March 2018. And then I called him on it, and I'm going to make sure he has his book out by March 2018.
Yeah.
Adriana, is there any tidbits of information, any lessons or upbeat moments that you would like to share with the audience that, you know, that to help them, because they are most likely a budding entrepreneur, or they're looking to scale their business, or they're trying to do something more to increase business. Is there any information that you would like to relay to them?
Yeah. One of the things is we have to learn to be natural. When we are natural, we don't have to worry about any other stuff. It's just to be us. And in that way, it's a special way to get connected with ourselves and allow yourself and allow to go to deep into your heart to see what is what you really want. Because many times people go for something different that they don't want to do just because it means more money or something. But at the end, we pay the bill. So the important thing is to do what you feel passion for. And also, it just don't let the fear stop you. There is always going to be fear. There is always going to be worries. And yes, it's going to be like me. Maybe it can take you 3 years to do the movement. But at the end, when you do it, it's going to be easy. And not to worry too much about one specific thing, because that specific thing maybe never is going to happen. But maybe another thing can probably is going to arrive. So it's just to be able to embrace the unknown, to live life and not to put too much stress into us trying to be perfect. Because when we are trying to be perfect, it's just we don't see other beautiful things that are around us.
And that is so, so true. And I've mentioned this quite a few times. If you go out there and just get started, and it's okay to be imperfect, but the thing is, you're going to learn from that. You're going to grow from that. An example that I've used and I've mentioned a couple of times is I started shooting video of real estate houses back in October 2009, using a little flip camcorder. And my first house that I recorded was a large house. I was about 60 pounds heavier than I am now. My hair was kind of messed up. I was wearing a polo type shirt. The house I was shooting had an older woman that the homeowner's mother was there. They had three small dogs. They had tile floor. The dogs were yapping. She had the TV on. And I mean, it was a horrible video. So of course I put it up on YouTube, and you know, since then I've recorded about 550 more videos over the course of the next few years. Let me ask you this, Adriana, do you think that video is still on YouTube? That horrible video?
Yeah.
Absolutely it is. Yeah. Because it's a testament of, okay, I'm getting started. And it's a reminder every once in a while. I dare the audience to go out there and find it. The YouTube channel is called Trident INV. You will see all the videos and put it in reverse order. Look at the oldest, the one for October 2009. It is a horrible video, but I got started. I went ahead and started. It was a huge fear being in front of the camera doing that. But after time, after doing that 200, 300, 400 times, you get accustomed to it. So yes, just get started and build.
Yeah, and that is part of the growing experience. And it's like, okay, when we were kids, we didn't know how to speak, we didn't know how to walk. So are we going to delete those moments? No, it's just we have to go through our own path. And you know, it's just everything is experience and everything makes us grow and learn. So yeah, certainly. It's like living there, like a comparison then, how much you have been growing, how much you have been expanding yourself. So it's a proof and it's beautiful.
Okay, well, thank you for sharing that. Now, Adriana, if somebody wants to get a hold of you because maybe they want to do their U.S. taxes, or maybe they live in both U.S. and Mexico, or maybe somebody's listening from Portugal and wants to understand how to do their taxes and stuff, what is the best way for them to contact you? Do you have a website that they can go to for them to get a hold of you?
Yeah, it's LPPINC.
LPP?
LPPINC .org.
.org. So it's LPP, like Larry Paul Inc., I-N-C, like incorporated, .org. So LPPinc.org. Okay. And they can fill out a contact form on there and also find out more about what you do and how your services can be of benefit to them. Fantastic. Well, Adriana, it's been a pleasure having you on the show. You were my first person that had businesses operating in two different countries on a regular basis. So thank you for doing that. I love having a bi-national, I guess you call it, entrepreneur.
International.
International entrepreneur. So again, thank you for being on the show. And any last words before we say goodbye to everybody?
Yeah, just saying go for what you want, have faith, love what you do, and you can do it.
Okay. Perfectly said. I'm not even going to repeat because you said it perfectly. So everybody, thank you for tuning in. If you like the show, please leave a comment. If you're on iTunes, please also leave a 5-star thing. If you have any information, please leave a comment because either myself or Adrian will try to answer it for you. If things that we can improve, let us know so that we can also make it a better show for you. Again, Adriana, thank you for being on the show. And I'm so glad you were here with us today.
Thank you, Kevin.
My pleasure. Goodbye, everybody.
Thanks so much for listening to this episode of Life's Little Lessons with your host, author of Designing Your Own Destiny, Kevin A. Dunlap. For more great content and to stay up to date, visit KevinADunlap.com, Facebook.com/KevinADunlap.author, and on Twitter @KevinADunlap. We'll catch you on the next episode of Life's Little Lessons.